Welcome to the week 8 of ITE 1712 web designing course. In this week, we are going to learn really interesting things. We are going to learn about the dynamic programming of HTML. We'll be using JavaScript to accomplish this task. As always, we will be following the same color coding pattern to identify what are the points represented in this presentation. After this week's learning, you will be able to design web pages with basic dynamic behaviors and inline scripts by using inbuilt JavaScript functions. This lesson will enable you to describe dynamic behaviors of web interfaces and use dynamic HTML elements, identifying the applications of JavaScript, write inline JavaScript using inbuilt functions, write inline JavaScript to display text with some calculations, and also write JavaScript with HTML elements and their attributes. Let's try something out. Let's create a JavaScript here. There are lots of JavaScript functions that we can use. One of these functions is document dot write function. If we put a string inside this function, for an example, this is dynamic. What this actually does is it writes this string just after the script tag. Okay, let's try that out. Right. Now the page shows this is dynamic text. So how can we make sure this is not the text that we entered inside the script? There is a way to check it. If you right click and inspect, here we can see actual dynamic source code. Now here we can see the script tag as well as the command, the function call that we have made. And after the script, we can see this, that this is dynamic text. That means our function call wrote this string within the HTML code dynamically. Let's try another code, another function. In JavaScript, we can get the system's date and time using date function call. Let's save it. A refresh, and we can see the current date and time of the computer that I'm using. So by using this method, we can write anything at the place where the script is running. But how can we change something within a given target element or given target HTML tag? For an example, now we can have a paragraph. Paragraph with an ID, para one. And this paragraph shall contain a text, something like original content. And let's delete this JavaScript function call and save this one and see. Okay, now it shows original content. Let's assume we want to change that content to another text. may be dynamic content. How can we accomplish that? First, we have to get the paragraph HTML tag and then change the contents of the tag. To do that, we can use the JavaScript like this. Document get element by ID and para 1, and then inner HTML equals dynamic content followed by a semicolon. Let's try that out. Right. Now we can see our paragraph is now having a dynamic content. How cool is that? So what can we do next? Let's create another heading, H1 ID, heading 1, old heading. Now, can you tell me how can we change the text of this H1 tag? I think you are correct. Instead of para 1, we have to get the element by the ID of the H1, that is heading 1, and change the inner HTML, the HTML inside the tag, to dynamic heading. Let's call it new heading. Save. Right. The headings changed to new heading. The paragraph has the original content. All right. Now let's do something more interesting. You have learned we can add images to HTML pages. So I'm changing the contents here. We have heading and we have an image. And I have copied two images, a kitten and a puppy, in this images directory, images folder. And let's refer the kitten first. kitten.jpg. And remove the JavaScript. Save it, and if we run the page, now we can see the kitten image is here. So let's change that image to the puppy one. How can we do that? Document we can do that by first get the element by the ID. Let's assign an ID here, my pet, and then change the src attribute of that element. Currently it is images kitten. Now change that to images puppy.jpg. Save. When you refresh it, we can see the image is now dynamically changed to the puppy one. So up to the previous lesson, you learned about the static web content designing. However, static web does not attract the audience. The dynamic behavior of web interface is categorized into two parts called server-side dynamic web interfaces and client-side dynamic web interfaces. Here, we learn about the client-side dynamic web interfaces. The dynamic behaviors such as displaying system time, verification of user inputs, and user environment scanning are done using client-side scripts. Have you seen web applications like Facebook or Gmail? Have you noticed they are really user-friendly and they don't take much time to update their content? They do not refresh the page every time they want to change the contents. They use these techniques to accomplish these interesting web application behaviors. A client-side dynamic web page processes the web page using HTML script running in the browser as it loads. The way page loads is determined by the JavaScript and other scripting languages. So outcome of HTML page is differ according to the script. The dynamic HTML or DHTML is a collective term for a combination of hypertext markup language tags and options use collection of technologies together to create user interactive and animated web pages that can make web pages more animated and interactive. Even games are being made using JavaScript. Very interesting games. Much of dynamic HTML is specified in HTML4. A simple example of dynamic HTML capabilities include having the color of a text heading change when a user passes a mouse over it and allowing user to drag and drop an image to another place on a web page. The dynamic HTML can allow web documents to look and act like desktop applications or multimedia productions. It uses combination of static markup language, example HTML, a client-side scripting language, example JavaScript, and the presentation definition language, example CSS, and finally document object model, and we call it DOM. So what is a script? A script are the programs written for special runtime environment that automate the execution of tasks that could alternatively be executed one by one by a human operator. Scripting languages are often interpreted rather than compiled. An interpreted language is a type of programming language for which most of its implementations execute instructions directly and freely without previously compiling a program into machine language instructions. The interpreter executes the program directly, translating each statement into a sequence of one or more subroutines already compiled into machine code. So the difference between a compiler and an interpreter is the compiler go through all the lines of code first and then create the machine language at once. When we execute the program, the whole program loads into the memory, the total machine code program loads into memory and then executes. But in an interpreted language, such as JavaScript, the lines are not compiled as such. Only one by one, the interpreter takes the code one by one and interpret and create the machine code and then run. So how these web scripts work? Scripts are invisible to the visitor side, but their availability within the code of a website defines how the website behaves in response to certain click requests sent by the user. Apart from the World Wide Web, scripts are also used for the automation of processes in a local computer. Each script represents a text document containing a list of instructions that need to be executed by a certain program or scripting manager so that the desired automated action could be achieved. This will prevent users from having to go through many complicated steps in order to reach certain results while browsing a website or working in their personal computers. The text nature of the scripts allows them to be opened and edited within the help of a basic text editor. As you already saw, we have used the basic Notepad to edit our code. So what is JavaScript? If you are thinking JavaScript related to Java, that's not true. Java and JavaScript are totally two different things. JavaScript is a scripting language that enables you to create dynamically updating content, control multimedia, animate images, and many more. JavaScript allows you to implement complex things on web pages. Every time a web page does more than just sit there and display static information for you to look at, displaying timely content updates, interactive maps, animated 2D and 3D graphics, scrolling video, probably consists with JavaScript. These client-side scripting languages are scripts which are executed in the client's browser, in the web user's machine. The important thing about such scripts is that their source code is visible to the web users if they wish to see it. Even when we were running our own program, we have opened an inspection window and looked at the code. One other way to look at the JavaScript code is simply to have to use the view source function of their web browser. This has helped a lot of novice programmers in their first steps and is a great way to learn the basics of client-side scripting, including JavaScript. There are two ways JavaScript can be integrated into your web page. The first way is to use them inline. That is what we did in our previous example. An inline JavaScript means JavaScript file is embedded on the HTML page inside head or body instead of an external JavaScript file. A script tag without a SRC, that is with code directly in the HTML document, attribute is referred to as an inline script. In the following example, an onClick attribute is called an inline event handler. Let's take a look. I have created this HTML file with the basic structure. Let's put the contents to this web page. Let's put an H1 tag. And a paragraph. Let's give it an ID. And let's create a button. Right. If we open this file, we can see there's a button, but it doesn't do anything when you click it. In the head section, we can create another section. And here we can create a function. Let's call it my function. And inside this function, we can execute something we did earlier. Let's get an element by its ID, get element by ID. And here, our paragraph's ID is demo. We will get the paragraph by using the ID demo, and we'll change the inner HTML of this paragraph to paragraph changed. Let's save and refresh. Now we can see this paragraph has a text of a paragraph. When you click it, the text is now changed to paragraph changed. How wonderful is that? We can define the behavior of our web page using JavaScript. One thing to note is that this JavaScript here is embedded in the head tag. And one other thing is here, the onClick event calls the my function, this my function method in the JavaScript embedded in this head tag. Not only in the head tag, we can include this JavaScript in the body as well. Let's cut this from here and place it even after we have defined the button. In this case, this my function calls this my function contains within the body tag. And here we have this function defined within the body tag. Let's run it and see. Yes, it works. With that, let's dig into these basic functions and their usage. A JavaScript function is defined with the function keyword. We already did it in our previous example. And this function keyword followed by a name and followed by parentheses. This function names can contain letters, digits, underscores, and also the dollar signs. Same rules as variables. These parentheses may include parameter names separated by commas. For an example, parameter 1, 2. The code to be executed by the function is placed inside the curly brackets. Here we can see this function has a name here and parentheses, and the body is within the curly brackets. Okay, now let's create a simple function in this new file. I have created the basic HTML structure. Okay, let's create an H2 tag here. Let's let's make it capital. And let's put a paragraph. This example calls a function which performs a calculation and returns the result. Let's put a semicolon and create another paragraph to get the results. Right. In our script, one note to make is this type attribute is now not necessary for scripts to run. We can have it or not have it. Let's define a function called my function. And in this case, we will create two parameters, parameter one and parameter two. And let's return parameter one multiplied by parameter two. And after defining the function, we shall use it. Document, get element by ID, demo. From that we capture this paragraph HTML element and set the inner HTML of that paragraph to the result of our function. Let's input 4 and 3. Right. Now here, the results of the function. If you inspect the paragraph, we can see the second paragraph has 12 inside it. But our initial code was empty. So what is the procedure in JavaScript? In general, a procedure is a term used in a variety of programming to define a series of steps taken together to achieve a consistent result. In this case, process outputs. A simple process may be described by a single procedure. But when it comes to larger processes, for an example, a revenue process, we might need multiple procedures to accomplish the overall task. Because in programming, it is best to separate each task into smaller procedures or functions. Let's take an example of making a tea. If we divide that making tea process into smaller steps, first we can pick our tea. That's the first step. And then boil the water. Get your tea and tea bags ready in the pot or mugs. And pour boiling water over the tea bag and stir briefly. Wait a few seconds and remove the tea bag. Add milk and sugar to the taste and then enjoy. So if we are going to create a procedure, it may also contain these steps. Now let's take a look at some variables, data types, and calculations in JavaScript. In JavaScript, we can have Boolean, number, string, Object data types. In programming, data types are an important concept. Because if we want to work on the variables, we should know what kind of data types we are going to hold in these variables. For an example, take a look at this example given. YX equals 16 plus Volvo. How can we evaluate this kind of a statement? Does it make any sense to add Volvo to 16? Will it produce an error? Or will it produce a result? That's why we need to understand what kind of data types we are using. JavaScript has dynamic types. Dynamic data types. This means that the same variable can be used to hold different data types. In some languages, this is not possible. In these languages, when we define a data type for a particular type, we can't use it anymore to contain other data types. But here it's very possible. At one point, it will be storing a string, but in the same program, it can hold any other, maybe an integer or a boolean. Now let's take a look at how we can use variables and data types in JavaScript. The first example, we will try to add two numbers. In JavaScript, we can define a variable by using the keyword var. Let's var x equals 10. This is the step one. And let's define another one. That's y equals 20. True. And then we will define another variable to hold the answer. This is step three. And finally, we can evaluate the answer by adding x and y. This is the step four. Right. Now, we will create an element here. Let's say, let's put an h1 tag, JavaScript. Procedures, and let's add a paragraph. This example guides you step by step procedure. Right. Then create another paragraph with ID demo. And close it. Now, after we get the answer, we shall show that answer in the demo paragraph. Answer. So rather than adding the answer only, we shall add another string as well. Addition of x and y is answer. This is the fifth step. So this procedure has 5 total steps. Let's run this program. Right. We created x as 10, y is 20, and the summation is 30. And we can see that in our page. So a var in JavaScript, a variable, can hold many data types, as we have discussed already. Let's define a variable called length equals 16. And let's define another variable called name summer. So the first variable holds a number, second variable holds the string. Not only that, we can hold the objects. For an example, person. We define objects by the curly brackets in JavaScript. And the object can have key value pairs. Or we can say attributes and their values. An example, first name, comma, last name, Kumar, like that. So if we want to display the name from this person, we can simply get the detail by person first name and concatenate the first and last name by a space. Right. Yes, we can write values from an object and even from a number and or directory. So let's create another file to demonstrate some data variable types. First one we are going to look at is the Boolean. So what is a Boolean variable? A Boolean variable can hold whether the value is a true or a false. For an example, let's say raining equals false. And then we can create a condition. We will get into this later, but for the moment we will use it. If raining, we can call a procedure called bring umbrella, something like that. So this Boolean variable at the moment is false. So this function, this procedure will not get called. But if the raining variable is true, then this procedure will call and something will result. Let's define this function. Bring your umbrella. If we make this variable false, that will not call this function or this procedure. Okay. Now I think you get an understanding what is the Boolean variable. Let's talk about numbers. Let's create a variable called num and assign the value 1. We can actually see the type of a variable by type of num. Let's write it to the document. It's a number. What if we have 2 or a minus value? Let's try this one. Again, it is number. Maybe we can enter as the type of num is number, right? What if we put a decimal value, maybe 0.3. Again, the type is number. So what about strings? We can create strings by using double quotes. The type of this last name variable is the type of this string is string. Let's create some objects. Let's create an object of a cat. Okay, the sound is meow. Let's see what is the type of this variable. It's an object, right? There are many ways we can create objects. This is one way. One other way would be something like this. Let's save and try. Yes, it also has the object type. Not only that, if we have another class somewhere and we have included it here, then we can create objects like this. Var cat equals, let's give it a name. Fluffy equals new cat. We can create objects from this cat class like this. Now there are lots of objects that we can use within a JavaScript. Date object and arrays, or even the functions that we talked about earlier. let's do some interesting experiment. Okay, if we have a variable called age, let's say it's 16, and we have a car, we call it Volvo. If we add them up, age plus car, what will happen? Let's try that out. Will this make any sense? If we don't have any data types defined, this doesn't make much sense. But if we interpret this one, we can see the result is 16 Volvo. That means the browser considered this age as a string. So these kind of assumptions are made in programming languages, and in JavaScript, this is the case. But let's try something else. Age is 16, and another number we assign 10, and we replace the car with the number, and now we have the sum. Let's try this out. Right. Now it considers all of both of the variables as numbers, and the engine sums them up and results 26. In this case, the data types are numbers. In the earlier case, the data types were strings. But what if we add double quotes into both of the variables? Then they get combined. Even if we have double quotes in one variable, the browser is smart enough to realize these are strings. Only if we don't have quotes, double quotes in all the variables, then only the browser realizes these are numbers. Let's do something interesting and mysterious. I write something to the browser. Okay, here. What would be the result? I think you already know. The result will be Volvo 10. That's correct. What if we add another number here? What do you think? Let's try that out. Volvo 10, and then we have 5. But what if we add the numbers before adding the string? Guess it. Take a minute and think. What would be the answer? Now it is 15 Volvo. Why? the interpreter sums the two numbers first and then realize, okay, this is a string. Then concatenate the result with the string. In earlier case, when we had the expression like this, it immediately identifies this as a string and then add 10 as a string and adds 5 as a string. This is one thing we have to keep in our mind when doing programming in JavaScript. Now in JavaScript, the data types are dynamic. What does that mean? Let's say we create a variable here called x. The value is 10. We shall write x plus 10 to the document. Then we will get right, that's correct. Then actually we can assign a string to the same variable. Even though the variable was a number before, will that produce a result? X. Let's comment the document writing part of the number and see what will happen. Yes, it does not give any error and it considers X as a string now. We can even concatenate other strings into it. Right. When we writing strings in JavaScript, we can either use double quotes or single quotes. What if we want to write a quote inside a string? Now we have this X my string. What if we put a quote here? That will give an error. It will not print here. If we inspect, if you go to the console, we can see unexpected identifier. That means if we, in our JavaScript, this is not recognized as a string because we have an unexpected quote here and there are another characters and another quote. So how can we write a quote inside our string? One way of accomplishing this is to use different kind of quotes. We can use double quotes here and include a single quote inside the string. Let's save and see. Oh, it's okay. My string with some other string. Now the string has a quote. Let's put something meaningful. It's all right. Now we can see the quote here. And also if we want to use a double quote in the string, we can actually use single quotes in the string and use the double quote inside. Something like this. It is Mica. Right. And also, we can even use double quotes here and escape the double quote within the string, like this. So let's take a look at numbers. In JavaScript, we can define numbers in different ways. One example would be 35, like this, with including decimals. One other way is without decimals, like this. And when we specify large numbers, very big numbers, we can use the exponential mark. For an example, x3 equals 10e5, or even x4 equals 10e-5. Let's write this down in the document. X3. Yes, 10 and 5 zeros, right? How about X4? Now it is 10 to the power minus 5. How about the JavaScript booleans? How do they work? Let's create a variable x equals 5, y equals 5, and z equals 6. In JavaScript, this is a comparison, and this returns true. If x equals y, we can say equal. If we say x equal is it, now we should see only if x and z are equal, this gets written into the document. Let's see. Only x and y are equal. So this evaluates to true and this evaluates to false. Now let's take a look at this buttons and functions. Let's create an h1 tag and click on this text. So when someone clicks on it, we need to do something. For that, we specify the onClick attribute here. We can access this h1 tag by using this. And then we can write some JavaScript inside in a HTML. Something like this. When somebody clicks on H1, this JavaScript runs without this script tag. Let's try that out. Click on the text. Right. Now it changed the text to oops. Rather than specifying this JavaScript within the tag itself, we can create a function. Change text. Then let's pass ID here. ID. Then we ID, because we returns, because we gets the object here, we can directly access it like this. And in this onClick event, we can pass this H1 object to this function. To do that, we can use this variable. We can say change text this. This keyword represents the H1 tag here. So we can directly access inside the JavaScript function. Let's save it. Right. It works.